They become sexually active, and then things tend to get worse for them, and so they tend to descend. What's also important here that we don't once again suggest that every young woman who is sexually active is depressed. And I think when you make claims in the public square about the link between sexual activity and psychological problems, as many abstinence advocates do, that you can lose credibility because many people who are engaged in this kind of activity are not experiencing depression. So you have to be careful to say that what's happening here, once again, is that we're increasing the risk for a certain subset of the population, and just to be aware of that. But it's also the case, too, that guys pay a price for a more kind of promiscuous orientation in the sexual arena. And the economist Joe Sabia, who's now at American University, has found that sexually active young men are doing significantly poorer in their academic work compared to their male peers who are not sexually active. And he says, quote, "The pleasures of sex may induce young men to choose immediate investments in sex over schooling," unquote. So I think what can be happening here, this is not rocket science. You know, you probably know guys who are kind of players. But basically, the sort of the status and the pleasure that they get from this kind of behavior can distract them from focusing on their work, and that has obvious consequences for them long term, both in terms of their education as well as their professional attainment. So one thing that's happening here is that what we're seeing in our colleges and our universities is that many schools, colleges, and universities have basically abandoned the task of organizing courtship. And courtship is a system of norms, of common practices, and roles that traditionally have guided young people into marriage. Whereas in our society, we don't have common norms, we don't have common practices, we don't have common roles when it comes to courtship, by and large. We have folks who are hooking up, folks who are hanging out, folks who are together 24/7, and some folks who are dating. There's kind of no one script, no one path that is sort of guiding a majority of young people. Yes?
Define courtship versus dating.
Well, I'm defining courtship here as it really relates to marriage. That's the big difference as I'm defining it here. So courtship is really designed to help prepare people for marriage, to give them a sense of whether or not this person that they're with right now would be a good spouse down the road. So when it comes to courtship and dating, young men and women in the U.S. are often clueless and confused. And they're also not being prepared well for a successful marriage. So why should sort of the end of courtship be marriage? As I mentioned yesterday, marriage is the institution in our society, and in most societies, that ensures that kids have the material, the emotional, the social, and the spiritual support of their mother and their father. It's also the case that marriage binds men to their families. So sociologically speaking, marriage is about bonding and it's about babies. Now, because we don't have a courtship system in our culture anymore, as most civilizations have, and as this country, had to a large degree up until about 40 years ago, I'm going to offer you some sort of do's and don'ts from the social and psychological literatures on relationships and on marriage. So a couple of don'ts and a couple of do's to kind of guide your path when it comes to courtship. Now, please raise your hand if you'd like to do something that would increase your risk of divorce, conflict, and marital unhappiness. Any takers out there? Okay. Well, cohabitation is linked in the literature to an increased risk of divorce, to less commitment, to more conflict, and to less happiness in marriage. And part of the story here is the selection story. That is the type of...